Father, I just thank you so much for the opportunity to minister your word. I don't take it lightly of what I say, Father, that but I'm here to declare your word. God, your word is so good. Appreciate it so much. It's changed my life and it keeps on changing me. And Lord, we have nothing else. I don't look for the power. I don't look for the signs, the wonders, the miraculous, the open vision, closed visions, dreams and all. Father, I look at your word produces all that. Your words, all those other things, it's a result of what your word has spoken. And you said in the last days we're going to see the greater signs. And so, Father, I pray, God, that every person that has come here, they come here expecting to receive. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to continue in the subject matter that I know it's a title that is very exciting. I'm being sarcastic. Transformation through, you know, transformation and through persecution. Through afflictions. Through the hard times. But we gotta sometimes have a reality check, you know, when we have a lot of stuff that comes against us and we complain, we're like the children of Israel often, Christians are. If you want to read about how Christians are today, just read in the Old Testament how a whole nation of Israel, how they acted towards God. God would bless them, and then when God would allow them to hunger and thirst, then they'd complain. God, what are you gonna do? Bring your people out here to die? You know, they totally forget about how good God is. You know, it's like God pulled us out of slavery. God pulled us out of sin. God pulled us away from the enemy that had us in bondage. And then we face difficulties in life. And then we start complaining to God, God, why are you allowing this to happen? God allowed the children of Israel to hunger. We read that last week in Deuteronomy 8. He allowed them to hunger, to test them, to find out, to see what was in their heart. Now remember, God already knows what's in your heart, but often we don't know what's in our heart. Why are we complaining? Why do we get upset when we feel the pressures of life? And we get Christians, sometimes they get upset, they don't even want to come to church because they're upset. Oh, really? I don't want nobody to talk to me and tell me anything. They're going to ask me how I'm doing because it shows in my face. So I'd just rather just stay at home. Good place to be. Because that's the way the enemy works. See, you want to hear God, but yet we hear the enemy more than we hear God. And the only reason why we can't hear God is because we're taking heed to the enemy's voice. If we start taking heed to the enemy's voice, then God can go ahead and interject of what he wants us to do. And he'll tell you. He says, you know what? Don't miss a heartbeat. Don't miss it at all. Just keep going and keep going no matter what you feel. Because in the process of all that, God is molding us. He's changing us. Praise the Lord. Amen. Say, well, I don't want to see so-and-so. You know, they may be upset. I need to be away from them, you know. Wait a minute. Doesn't the Bible say? Yeah, go by the Bible. Doesn't the Bible say iron sharpens iron? Maybe God's using them to sharpen you up. Amen. See, so what you need to do is then say, okay, you know what? I'm going to go against what I feel, what I think. You know what? I need to put aside of what I think, and I need to stay in obedience to what God's word is saying, and because God has a bigger picture of what he wants to do in me. And if I have to go through the sufferings, then it's okay. Bring it on, because you know what? I may not see, but God, you see the whole thing of where you want to bring me into. And so therefore, you know what I'm going to do while I'm going through that? I'm just going to trust you. And God says, that's what I wanted you to do from the very beginning. Amen. Praise the Lord. You see, it's so sad that God is trying, is so much working with people to trust. And we have such a breakdown of trust because we trusted people. But you know what? Let's look at it. The Bible says, again, Bible, don't lean upon the arm of flesh, because you're going to be disappointed. There's times, not intentionally, I may disappoint you. Don't hold it against me. Just start figuring out, how come you're acting the way you're acting? How come you're feeling the way you're feeling and thinking the way you're thinking, and you come up with another opinion? So you can go ahead and complain to God all you want, and He'll hear you, but He can't move in you until you finally give it up. I say, oh God, okay, I'm through. I'm through complaining. Go ahead. I was reading the scripture there just before coming here in Deuteronomy 8, and that we had read last week. And he said that, he said, I've come and I allow you to suffer hunger, okay, pressure, and to thirst. He goes, but see, then my father gave you manna. And manna represented who? Jesus. Jesus comes in John and he says, I am the bread of life. Your father's ate of the manna, the bread. And that's the reason why he goes on to say in the Old Testament, man does not live by bread alone. Jesus goes and says the same thing when he was being tempted, when the devil says, here, turn this rock into bread because you're hungry. He was not going to be led by the temptation. He was going to still be obedient and not submit to it like Adam did. And he said, man does not live by bread alone. Jesus quoted the word. He defeated the temptation through the word of God. And see, God, the back end, they rejected the manna. You know what they said? This is what came to me. They said this. They said, we're tired of this manna. Oh my God. You know what that is? It's a rejection when we start doing and acting that way and complaining of the Son of God and all that He's done for us. We just rejected Him. God got upset back then. He goes, okay, all right. I'm going to give you meat. And it's going to come out of your, it's going to come out of your ears. I mean, you're going to be so full, you'll be throwing it up. God was upset. But it wasn't good enough of what God was giving man out there, a nation of Israel out there, the bread. That bread of life, they needed that life at that moment. If they didn't have that bread, they would have died out there in the wilderness. But God took the responsibility to take care of them. I'm going to give you this manna. And you don't have to go work for it. Just go out there and gather it up and eat of this all the whole time. This whole time while you're out here in the wilderness, I'll take care of you. You can make all kinds of things out of it, but they complained. You see, we always complain about things we don't got instead of being grateful for the things that God has given to us. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Amen. God, what wants to do, because He will allow us to experience the sufferings in order to be able to change our lives. But if there's something that stands in the way of our flesh, then there are things around us that's going to bring a pressure for us to be able to identify what stands in the way. If there's selfishness that is there, that all we think is about ourselves, then that's the thing that God needs to squeeze out. Because if you go and you think you gain the whole world and it's all about you, and we live in a generation that believes and has an entitlement. They have an entitlement issue. You owe it to me. You don't owe, then nobody owes you nothing. That's the part that God wants to kill. Praise the Lord. That's the reason why we have to go, ouch, that hurts. Yes, I'm going through it. Yes, it's okay. It's all right. God knows what he's up to. It's okay. Oh, okay, I see. I see that ugly part of me right there. Oh, the way I'm acting. I'm acting snobbish. Oh, I'm being very opinionated. Oh, I got this. Oh, man, I'm complaining. Oh, yeah, I got this. Oh, my God, I got this attitude because of this person. Because when they get close to me, oh, I just get irky inside of me. If you keep getting that over, that's right there. It's a sign. Hello, you're not getting it. What's that person? No, it's not that person. It's your attitude. That's the part that God wants you to get rid of. And then we come to church. Oh, yes, thank you, Jesus. You know, we sing songs and praise and all that. No, no, you'll never break through. You won't break through. Oftentimes people come to church and they come with all the cares of life, and you can tell. You can tell, well, I know the way you see me. I know the way you see my face. I know I wear my emotions on my sleeve. Get it off your sleeve. I don't stand up here and share all the hard things that I'm going through in my life, and oh man, please pray for me. You know, I had a little bout with my wife the other day, and then I have, you know, I'm not going to go and tell you. No, I didn't have one either, but I'm not going to go and tell you all these things. You know, we had some little things here and there, but it's just normal stuff. It's just realizing that, okay, that's okay, we got to change that. Oh, there's something else we got to change. I mean, after, what, 45 years, we're still changing, making adjustments? Yeah. Yeah. See, because we're humans, that we tend to get very comfortable. So, that's just the way they are. That's what, okay, well, that's where they're always going to be. And that's what, you know what, they say that? They say, well, this is the way you made me. This is the way I'm going to be. You know, so you know what? You get what you get, and that's it. No, what you just said, you're just so stubborn, you're not going to change for nobody, not even for God. See, you got to read it between the lines. See, my job, you know, and God has really helped me and perfected me more and more. But I listen to what people don't say. I hear them talking, and I said, let me tell you what you just said. Especially among couples, you know. I go, you know what, you just said this and you just said that. Or let me help you. Or let me help me to understand this. This is what I heard you say. Then I might go to the husband and I might go and say, you know, but did you hear what she just said? Because he's ready to jump in. I says, wait, listen to what she just said. It's all good. She says, yeah, I heard that. Okay, what'd she say? And he didn't get it. I says, here, let me interpret it for you what she just said. You know, we say, you get that? You're a guy, you get that? Yeah, I had to learn. Do I got it all? No, I don't. I'm still learning. That's why I'm still married. But I'm learning new things. I'm learning eye contact. I'm learning body language. I'm learning voice, the tone of voice. I'm learning that I just can't go out and just do whatever I want to do and say whatever I want to say. You know, I can't do that. And sometimes we treat one another in the same manner. No, you don't do that even with children. One child would be more sensitive than the other. And with a person who's not as sensitive, you know, you got to get a little harder. Person is sensitive, and, you know, my son was a little bit stubborn. I mean, he was a little hyped up and everything, like it was fun with him. And then my other daughter was leaning up a little bit. But to my last one, it's like, look at her, it looks like I'm getting ready to, you know, I'm disappointed. She just breaks down and cries. I'm not going to whip her, spank her, nothing. You know? It's like, what the heck before? You know? She already knows. She already getting it. You know, so it's like, see, every person is different. So your approach is that, God is that way with us too. I've had preachers that said, you know, God was so strong with me, and he told me this, boom, boom, boom. You know what? God's never done that with me. You know, God's been strong, but he's never going, so, you know what? What is wrong? No, he never did that with me. He's been tender with me. He just loves me. He keeps telling me that he loves me, and just that love alone what motivates me to want to serve him, motivates me to want to obey him. Hey, Lord, whatever you want me to do. And it teaches me to, or it motivates me to want to trust him. Because you know what? Love will never hurt. It'll never hurt me. His love for me will never hurt. So I'm going to just I'm going to put myself out there. See, these are the things that we need to learn. But oftentimes, we don't know what's inside of us, but we discover when we go under pressure. Just watch what comes out of your mouth. Because Jesus says, out of the abundance of your mouth, your heart is speaking. Out of the abundance of the heart, your mouth speaks. You always identify where people are at. I can identify with Grandma within 10 minutes, 10, 15 minutes. So I let a person talk, and I know where you're at. I know where you're coming from. Because it comes out from the heart. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And a lot of it, of course, has a lot to do with the Holy Spirit. You know, I totally attribute it to the Holy Spirit. But I do it, I've done it so long, so many years, that the Holy Spirit just boom, boom. I can tell that even the measure of some people's spirituality. I say, I don't know everybody, okay. But I'm just saying, in general, I can tell somebody's spirituality where they're at. I can tell somebody that can, as they're talking, they're talking how spiritual they are, you know, that they're not as spiritual as they're saying. So oftentimes you just give yourself away, just like somebody says, man, you know, I got so much faith and all. Okay, got this level. You know? Because a person that really has great faith and all that, they don't have to try to prove it to anybody. And all you're trying to do is trying to prove it to yourself. Try to talk yourself into it. And you don't have it. So if you're not there, it's okay if you're not there. But go in that direction so you can get there. And the way you're going to get there is when you're under pressure. Look at Philippians 1:29. Then I want you to go to 1 Peter 4:1. And then I want you to... You can use all your fingers. It says, for to you it has been granted. Say to me. Say to me. Say to me. Okay, so is this talking to us? Okay, it's talking to us. For to you it has been granted on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in Him, but also to suffer for His sake. Having the same conflict which you saw in me, Paul's talking here, in me, and now here is in me. You're hearing about me. Now, this book of Philippians, Paul wrote it. Where was he?
Prison.
He was in prison. You see the conflicts that I'm going through. He says, so, you know what? I'm doing this on behalf of Christ. See, so I believe in Him, and I'm suffering for His sake. Because what God started, what He began in us, He's going to bring it to its completion. It is a work. We are a work in progress. Some could go faster than others. And the only, don't ever get jealous with other people that if they move, seem to move faster than you, don't get jealous over that. In fact, let that be a motivation for you to do something about it. Because you and I are on the level of our faith today based upon the measure of obedience we're operating under. Huh? The measure of cooperation. If you're resisting, don't cry if you're not where you need to be. Because you can get there. And I said before, and scripture does say this, God is patient with us. He's long-suffering with us. If you make a whole bunch of mistakes, God is the umpire. So He calls it the shots. And we could always do it over and over again because of His long-suffering. But the thing is that the quicker you give up yourself, the quicker you will get to the level of the position that God wants you to be. So you can keep the momentum moving. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Jesus went through the trials, through the trials and the persecutions of life. Now, arm yourself likewise. Jesus, if he did it, why do you think that we're not going to do it also? The Bible, I'm just going to throw this out there, but the Bible tells us in Hebrews 4:8, it says, though he was a son, yet learned he obedience by the things that he suffered. Wow, the Son of God. The Son of God. And we complain and want to get out, and we want the easy way out. No, there is no easy way. We gotta carry our cross. Jesus said we have to carry our cross every day. And it gets heavy at times. But see, the reason why the cross is a reminder of what we are to do with the flesh, with self. So the cross represents what? The crucifying of the flesh, which is death. Death. So when we rise up and get upset about something, God is reminding us that part has to die. Every time it comes up, oh, I gotta die. If you messed up, put your and you said things to somebody, get it right real quick. Because the enemy will use that against you right away. If you offended somebody, go over there and make it right. What if they don't receive it? That's on them. And if somebody's trying to get it right with you, get it right. Because it'll be on you. Amen. We have scripture after scripture that I don't have time to get into, but as time goes on, I will be teaching on it. Scripture after scripture is telling us how we are to keep things in order as a church, as Christians, as a body. Everything, every question that we have, every situation that we're confronted with, there is a solution in the Bible of how to operate in it, how to work through it. It's all there. I find it there. 1 Peter 4, verse 1. Therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, as he did, arm yourselves also with the same mind, for he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lusts of men, but for the will of God. See that? Now, it says, now I want you to jump over for a moment here, verse 15. Let none of you, in fact, that whole chapter will work for you, but we don't have time for that. But let none of you suffer as a murderer. Now here, I'm going to teach you something here. As a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters. So if you get something from somebody and it's because you were the cause of it, don't think you're suffering for Christ. You're suffering for your own actions, your own behavior, you're experiencing your own consequences. So don't think you're suffering for Christ. All these people are against me and all that. Maybe you were a busybody going in and dropping notes into other people, putting wrong stuff into their ear. And then now they're talking about other people, they're talking about you. And then you look and you say, well, people are talking about, oh, they're just a bunch of gossiping people in church. Guess what? And then, see, and you're the innocent party, but yeah, you're the one that started.
Amen.
I've seen that over and over. And so we think that we're suffering for Christ. You're not suffering for Christ. You're suffering for your own actions. He says, don't think. It didn't say that. But let not none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or a busybody in other people's matters. Stick with your own problems. Work out your own issues. When somebody is doing something, you know, you're going to have people that just are going to do things differently than you. Just settle that. They're going to act differently. You know, there's a whole bunch of personalities sitting right here. Huh? Your personality didn't get saved. Some people get irritated with personalities. That's all. He says, you know what I look at? There's all kinds of different personalities, and I look and I just laugh. I say, oh, God made us so different. God made us so unique. Because you know what? My personality probably irritates somebody. So whenever I hear somebody say, oh man, they just irritate me. Well, don't you think somebody out there gets irritated by you? I mean, you think you're somebody that just people are just falling all over you? I mean, right now, to this day, my wife and I have different personalities. But there's certain personalities that irritate me about her. There's certain personalities that irritate me about her. Me. Yes. That I irritate. You know? I got a certain personality that, you know, sometimes, just the other day, I put myself up there. Don't use it against me. I don't know. Sometimes, you know, so I'm serious with things. I take seriously with everything with gospel. I'm ministering to people all day long, and I'm out there, you know, just put, you know, ministering to people's lives and counseling and all and doing it. I take it seriously. But sometimes when I go home or something, I may just act real silly. You know? And sometimes my wife is just not ready for it. I mean, I'm talking about it back silly. But sometimes I'll tell her, I know you're irritated, but see, the silly part is what I do is I tease. You know, I'll tease her, and she'll say something, and I'll just come with a tease or something, or with a sarcastic remark and stuff. And, you know, you're probably listening to me, you know, some of you, and saying, well, I'd probably get upset too if you do that way for me. You know, see, I told you. But then before I used to think this, whenever she would do that, I'd get upset. Oh man, I'd get, what do you want? You want me to be serious all the time? Is that the way you want me to be? Then I'll just be serious. And I'm just going to be just upset all the time. Huh? Is that what you want? See, I used to do that. Now it's like, okay, I know. I'm acting silly. I understand that. It's all right. But see, that's my personality. But it has nothing to do with my gift. It has nothing to do with my spirit. It has nothing to do that, you know, I'm less than, you know. It has nothing to do with that at all. God uses me. God ministers through me. God loves me. He loves the whole package. And so if you get married, you're going to marry the whole thing. Okay? So you're going to have some pros and you're going to have some cons. So there's no such thing as having all pros. We're not in heaven yet. Okay? So get over it. Alright? But sometimes we allow those things to affect us. And then we use that against other people. Why are they doing that? Why are they acting that way? Why are they talking that way? That's them. Leave them alone. See, the enemy, what he wants us to do is so much concentrate on what other people are doing or not doing. And we begin to lose sight of what the work that God's doing in my life. Praise the Lord. So if you notice, and this is a sign for yourselves, for all of us, is that when we start thinking about the other person that's really irritating us, the enemy's got you. He's got your attention. And then he entertains it and starts putting some more stuff about that person. And then you're reminded about some of the things that he did do. And now you're really irritated. And the enemy just worked you. See, we can't be ignorant of his devices. I'm trying to make some realize the characteristics of the enemy, what he does. And so what you have to do is at the moment you start, because you can't help it, it's going to happen. But the thing is, once you start and you start thinking that and you start thinking your feelings about somebody, immediately you stop it. I says, why am I thinking about that bad about that person? That's the person that Jesus died for. That's the person that Jesus is in love for. That's the person that Jesus spilled his blood for. I gotta remember that. Like my wife and I would play around, you know, and I would say, don't talk like that with me. I'm God's son. Don't mess with me. You know? Of course, she's God's daughter, too. You gotta be careful to mess with God's daughters. I believe this. I really believe this. Because this. Why is it? I got two daughters and a son. And my son, somebody messes with him and all of them, take that stuff. Whatever. It's okay. Somebody messes with my son. I'm in there. Don't touch my daughters. Okay. If I'm that way as an earthly father, what do you think?
Yeah,
that's right. Heavenly Father is. So I am very careful with how I mess with God's daughter at home. Even if I get irritated, I'm saying, that's his daughter. And I'm just going to love her. You know, because I want this to be clear right here, because he's all I got, and I want this open all the time, because the Bible tells me that if I mess with this, that my prayers are hindered. Read some scripture, so there, and I know that, so that therefore I'll make this, keep this clear, so I can have this. So that way, when I am irritated, I can go off and continue to have this, because I keep the right attitude. That's what you call guarding your heart. So the enemy doesn't creep in. Let me tell you, I can tell you all kinds of stories through the years of our married life, that the enemy could always creep in because I invited him in, because I entertained it. And you take you to places that you don't really want to go. And now I don't go there, I don't visit there at all. And it feels good. I'm not a slave. I'm not a slave. Praise the Lord. See, I'm helping you so you can stay in a place of freedom. Why feel free when you come to church and then go back, go out there to be weak and then and struggle and get back in bondage again? There are so many Christians that are bound up. They're bound up in themselves. But oftentimes you get bound up because of what you think about the other person. I'm helping you. So, if you suffer for other because of what you've done, you're not suffering for Christ. Therefore, verse 19, therefore, jump in there. Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God. That's how it puts it now. Those that suffer according to the will of God. Commit their souls to Him in doing good as a faithful Creator. Praise the Lord. So I need to stay in the will of God. So, when sufferings come, trials of life come, I know God is up to something. He's there to reveal who I am and what stands in the way between our relationship together that I need to take care of. See, we think that, okay, if God wants to remove that, he'll remove that. You know, God can do this and God can do that. God can't do nothing until we cooperate. So when something is shown about you, God reveals it because of the pressure that you're under, and then you act a certain way, then it's your responsibility to acknowledge it and get it taken care of and put it under the blood of Jesus. That you've been forgiven of that kind of an attitude. Amen. So you don't carry it with you. So when the rapture takes place, you're light. Right? Be lightweight. Just go. Let me round this up right here. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10. Let me give you an answer here. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10, verse 7. There is the word grace. It says, in Ephesians 2:8, it says that for by grace are you saved, right? Right? Okay. For grace we're saved. So grace is always activated to bring salvation. And we are right now being saved. Okay. We're being saved from what? What do you think? It's always taken care of. We're being saved. See, our only self that comes up, God wants to save us from that. Right? He wants to save us from that. Okay. Grace, see, I can paint this picture to you. Grace is everything that God says that you are. We're sons, we're daughters, we've been chosen, we're adopted. He has raised us up. He's delivered us. He's forgiven us. Okay, all these things. Grace reminds us of everything that God did that we didn't deserve. But he just gave it to us. Grace doesn't have to work to get it. Grace doesn't have to work to go and we have to be accepted. I'm working so I can be accepted of God. No, grace says you already are. Grace says you already are forgiven. Okay. So grace is a reminder of all the attributes that God and all the promises that God has given unto us. Grace reminds us of that. So it says, for by grace are you saved. Okay. Now, Paul the Apostle went through some things in his life in this particular time. He says, there was a thorn in the flesh. He says, lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations and thorns in the flesh was given to me a messenger of Satan to buffet me. Lest I be exalted above measure. Now, notice, when God moves on you, and you have different experiences with God, and you have a gushers of the Holy Spirit moving on you, and you may have revelations and insights of the word that the Holy Spirit has given to you, and it feels so good and all that, the enemy's not going to stand around and watch you grow. Okay? You may be so blessed coming Thursday or Sunday and all, and maybe you had an encounter with God, and then you go come Monday and all of a sudden, boom, you're hit with something. That's exactly how the enemy works. Okay? To bring discouragement. All right. Paul had an abundance of revelations. He had visions and dreams. He had all these supernatural things. And see, the enemy is not going to sit around and watch you have all those things. So now, what happens is that God will allow this so your dependence is not upon the revelations, is not upon the dreams, is not upon the visions, is not upon the science. See, your dependence will be totally upon all the promises that God says that you are. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So he says this. Now, concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, watch what he says, I will rather boast in my infirmities, my weaknesses, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong.
Yeah.
Wow. You know what religion teaches on these scripture verses right here? And I've heard pastors do it. They teach that God said no. That God was not going to remove that from me. But we read last week, and if you recall, it was a scripture, we're not going to it, in 2 Timothy 3, verses 11 and 12, where Paul went through the cities, and he went through the persecutions, but he said, God delivered me from them all.
Yes.
All of them.
Yes.
Okay? So now, what God was doing here, Jesus was doing here with Paul, reminding him of the grace of God. You got saved because of God, of God's grace, and you couldn't even get yourself saved, and you can't keep yourself saved. Just focus upon the grace of what I've done for you and enjoy it. That alone will strengthen you and give you hope. So you're not going to be stuck in your complaining and you're stuck in something you don't have or stuck in something that you're going through. See, you're going to be going through it because you know what? Grace says that he'll never leave me nor forsake me. That he's going to be with me throughout. Even unto the ends of the world. Jesus said that. I'll be with you all the way to the ends of the earth. The end hasn't come yet. That means he's still with us. I don't care if you don't feel him. That's why you can't rely upon what you feel. You can't rely upon your dreams, upon your revelations, upon the supernatural things. You can't rely upon that. You just rely upon the promises of God. That will never fail. That's where your strength comes. And see, what I do is I start feeding on that. There's an inner strength that comes. You can't even explain it. It just comes. That's why Paul goes and says that. He says, okay, well, you know what? In that case, I'm going to glory. I'm going to rejoice in my infirmities. And all my weaknesses that I go through. And all those turmoils and persecutions that I go through. I'm just going to rejoice. I don't have to understand it. Because I know one thing. That Jesus, the Father's on the throne, Jesus is at the right hand, and guess what the Bible tells me? It says that he is interceding for me, and he's praying for me, and guess what? Jesus' prayers are answered, and therefore I'm going to stand on behalf of his prayers, and I'm going to still remain standing.
Amen.
Hallelujah! Praise the Lord. That's the reason why I never dreamed I'd be in this position. And again, not that I've arrived. I'm still working like you. I still fight the devil like you do. But the thing is, as I'm enjoying the journey.
Yes.
That's why it's exciting to be a Christian.
Yes.
I get to wake up with the peace of God. I get to wake up knowing that there's another day that I get to live for God. I get to know another part of God today. Because all I want is God. And my heart just goes out to him all the time. It's all the time. And I'm not boasting over what I'm doing. I'm just boasting over what God does as a result of what I'm doing. The thing is, I want to make it so tangible for you to know that that's what is going to help you out of your situation. Of whatever you're going through in your life. You're going to come right out of it. And you're gonna be smelling like a rose. You're gonna be a sweet smelling savour in the nostrils of God.
Yes.